Hello students, we are covering part 3 of your chapter 6, Learning, class 11, Psychology. In this part, we shall talk about operant conditioning, which is the second type of conditioning. In the previous part, you learnt about classical conditioning. The basic two types of conditionings in your syllabus and also recognized in the journal World of Psychology are classical and operant. Let us talk of operant conditioning now. The objectives of this part are, after going through this, you should be able to understand the meaning of operant conditioning. You should gain acquaintance with various terms used in operant conditioning. You would also come to know of the factors that affect operant conditioning. You will be able to relate the differences between classical and operant conditioning and also see the application of operant conditioning in your day-to-day life. On your screens, you can see the picture of B.F. Skinner, who is the father of operant conditioning. Hence, it is also known as Skinnerian conditioning because it was given by this person. He is a very renowned psychologist, and this concept has come to be related with the processes of learning and also solving of certain psychological problems in our world today. Let us see what this interesting and very useful concept is. Operant conditioning is also known as instrumental conditioning. You shall come to know why it is given this name. It was given by B.F. Skinner, and the terms that we basically use are operants, reactions, stimuli, and aversions and rewards for describing this kind of conditioning. What are operants now? These are the voluntary reactions. These are emitted voluntarily and are under control of the organism. The organism decides whether to perform a certain learned behavior or not. This is in contrast to the classical conditioning, where the reactions dealt with were reflexes, where the organism had no control. The experiment that was used by B.F. Skinner to establish this concept of operant conditioning was conducted in a small laboratory. The subject used was a rat. So, there was a Skinner box which was made in which the rat was kept. The conditioning was established, operant responses and their consequences were seen. Let us see what this experiment was. You can see the picture of a proverbial Skinner box here with a rat placed in it. This box had a small funnel kind of a tube in which certain food pellets were inserted, and then there was a lever attached at the bottom of this funnel. If which it was pressed, the food pellets would come down and fall into a plate. The rat could then have them to be eaten from that plate. So that means a funnel, a lever, a food plate, and a box in which a rat is placed. These were the basic ingredients of a Skinner box. Now, every time the rat accidentally happened to press this lever, a food pellet would fall from there. Now, you can understand that pressing a lever is not a part of the natural environment of a rat. A rat does not usually get its food by pressing levers. But in this laboratory condition, the rat would be roaming about. The rat was kept hungry, of course, to be motivated enough to be roaming and doing certain activities in anticipation of getting food. Accidentally, the rat happened to come and press the lever. He did not know what he would get after that. And he did not even know that his pressing the lever has resulted into gaining of food. This trial continued for some time. The rat would be roaming around, coming, accidentally pressing the lever and then getting the food. After some trials, the rat came to associate the action of pressing the lever with getting the food. So then the rat would come to the box, go near the food plate, press the lever, 1, 2, 3, 4, get the pellets, eat them, be satisfied and rest. Next time when he would need food again, he would go, press the lever, get the food. So this experiment came to establish something very interesting, that even if you have not naturally learnt a behavior, that behavior is giving you certain rewards which are known as reinforcement, gets you to learn the behavior. So the response is instrumental in getting the food. You learn to operate mechanical instruments in your real life going by this kind of conditioning. Another example, human beings usually acquire shortcuts to attain their goals in life going by the principle of operant conditioning. There was not a way taught to you. Certain maladaptive behaviors are also learned due to this. Your teachers and parents always told you that if you learn, if you do hard work, you will fare better in your exams. And one certain time maybe you were very less prepared for your exam. What you happened to do was your best friend was sitting on your side and you took his sheet and cheated, and this gave you good marks. Now nobody taught you this behavior, but getting good marks because of cheating established the behavior in your mind. Isn't it the way that thieves are usually formed? They perform an activity which everybody says is bad, is illegal, is immoral, but they get a reward because of that, and then they come to associate, okay, this activity, stealing, gives me a reward. And then therefore the conditioning happens. They steal, they get rewarded, they steal, they get rewarded. And to be able to get rid of this activity, another kind of conditioning has to be established, that is stealing and getting punished. Another example, children learn to be polite after they are given operant responses. You say please or thank you and you are given a toffee. Your parents repeat this behavior. Gradually you will learn to say please and thank you in anticipation of getting a toffee, because that reward makes you learn a behavior. So now you see, what is operant conditioning? How Skinner established this concept? What was his basic lab setting? And how in our day-to-day lives we apply it and we see its application happening around us? But of course, we need to know the definitions as well. So let's define. The form of learning in which behavior is learned, maintained or changed through its consequences is the operant conditioning. These consequences are known as reinforcers. And these reinforcers by definition are any stimulus or event which increases the possibility of occurrence of a desired response is a reinforcer. The another name which is given to operant conditioning is instrumental conditioning. By now, you would have guessed why this name is given to it. Because the organism is instrumental in getting the consequences or the reinforcer that are given to him. Nothing comes naturally. Only if the rat would have pressed the lever, he would have got food. He would not be given food like a dog harnessed in a lab in a Pavlovian experiment. Only if a child says thank you, he would be given a candy. Only if you work hard, you would be given marks in your exams. Only if you are doing a wrong thing, you would be slapped. So, every time the organism is instrumental in getting the response or the consequence that he gets. Therefore, the name instrumental conditioning. Now, what are the determinants of operant conditioning or instrumental conditioning? What do we mean by determinants? Well, these are the features that affect the strength of a response. How quickly the learning is established. What are the factors that influence when a subject will learn to perform a certain kind of a behavior? There are six types of determinants for operant conditioning. The first determinant that establishes how quickly operant conditioning would occur is the type of reinforcement used. There are basically three kinds of reinforcers: positive, negative, and punishment. Positive reinforcers are the ones that result in pleasant consequences. They satisfy certain needs. For example, quenching of thirst, satisfying of hunger, getting rewarded, getting appreciated, feeling of self-esteem is enhanced. Any kind of thing that leads to a happy or a good kind of a reinforcement is a positive reinforcement. For instance, a child gets a smile for answering a question in the class. The child feels elevated. Or you dress up nicely and your friends really appreciate you. You feel as if this appreciation has come because of my dress. So you learn to dress up neatly and smartly in the future also. The second is negative reinforcers. These are painful stimuli which result in avoidance or escape reactions. Anything that you do and you get pained, and therefore you stop doing the thing. Punishment being the third kind of reinforcer, it's something that gives you the indication and suppresses your behavior. For instance, the light was red on a road and you were crossing it and a vehicle came and you got mildly hurt and got an accident. So what you would learn? Because of the punishment, that behavior of crossing the road when the light is red gets suppressed. so suppression of reactions is resulted in. Research shows that operant conditioning is the best when avoidance or negative stimuli are used. So, negative reinforcers result in the quickest learning through operant conditioning. The second determinant is the number or frequency of reinforcement given. The third is the amount of reinforcer. How much of the reinforcer is given? How many times it is given? Every time you do a good deed and you are given a candy as a child, you would learn quickly. If a candy is given only sometimes when you do a good deed, then you would learn slowly. The amount of reinforcer, if supposedly doing something nice, you were given one big chocolate, and on the other side, you did something else which was nice, you were given only one toffee. So, the amount was bigger when there was a chocolate or maybe four chocolates were given. Then the learning would occur quickly. The fourth is the quality of reinforcer. Whether the reinforcer is superior or inferior. If a reinforcer is given to an organism which is much desired at the time, then it is called a superior reinforcer. In Skinner box, the rats that were used were hungry and they were given food pellets. So, these were superior reinforcers. If these hungry rats were only given some behavior which was like the box was made a little more heated because it was cold, this would be an inferior reinforcer because at that particular time, the basic need of the rat was to satisfy its hunger rather than the temperature needs. On the other hand, if the environment was really very cold and the rat was feeling very, very uncomfortable, then decreasing the amount of cold and raising the temperatures would be a superior reinforcer. The next determinant is schedule, that is delivery of reinforcements during conditioning trials. How many times a reinforcement is provided during the conditioning trials? At what frequencies it is provided? This determines the schedule. There are basically three kinds of schedules that can be followed: continuous, partial, and delayed. Continuous schedule, as the name implies, is when each trial would give you a reinforcer. Every time a rat presses a lever, he would get food. Every time a child does a good deed, he would get rewarded. Every time you work hard, you would get good marks. So, if this happens all the time and in a laboratory situation, every time maybe a pigeon pecks on a right button, he would get rewards. So, this is continuous schedule. The second type is partial schedule, where on certain times a reinforcer is given and on certain times it is not. Research has shown that learning is very slow when partial schedules are used. This is because the organisms get confused. They are not able to relate whether the reinforcer was delivered because of a certain action they were providing or it was just by chance. Another is delayed schedule, where the desired action gets the reward but after some time. For example, your teacher tells you, if you answer questions in the class, I will give you gold points on your conduct chart. And you answer a question, the teacher does not give you the gold points immediately. It is only after 2-3 days that a gold point comes, or maybe a star is given on your notebook. So, the learning again would be slow. Research has again shown that only immediate reinforcers, whether they are positive reinforcers or negative reinforcers, result in better conditioning. Delayed reinforcers result in slower conditioning. The next determinant is the nature of response that is to be conditioned. What kind of response do you expect the organism to give? If this is a response which is natural to the organism, the learning is quicker. If this is a response for which the preparedness is less, the learning is slower. This would also explain the games that you see. A whale recognizes a red ball from a blue ball more quickly. So does your dog. But if you're trying to teach the same thing, maybe to a rabbit, it would be slower because the nature of response that you were establishing was more unnatural to a rabbit than it is to a whale. Another factor that determines how quickly operant conditioning will occur is the interval between the occurrence of a response and a reinforcement. Now that you understand what is operant conditioning, you would be curious to know where can it be used as a psychologist. Skinner did a number of experiments with rats and pigeons. And basically, this conditioning was used in war situations, where pigeons were trained to recognize bombs, where rats were trained to see what is dangerous and where is it located. In the laboratory, many psychologists have done interesting experiments using, again, rats, pigeons, chimpanzees, and apes. In human beings also, a lot of times it is used. The most important concept and the therapy which is based on operant conditioning is shaping, where a behavior is gradually established or suppressed in a human being by giving reinforcers level by level. You give 1 toffee, 2 toffee, 4 toffees and 10 toffees again to a child. A schizophrenic is to be taught to wear glasses. This person is given certain reinforcers gradually. Now that the applications are also clear, you would be wondering, is there a difference between classical conditioning, that is the Pavlovian conditioning, and the Skinnerian conditioning, that is the instrumental conditioning? Of course, there are many differences. Some of them you would have come to realize yourself. Let us do a quick recap of what these differences are. The first one is the different type of responses that are conditioned. In classical conditioning, the responses are under the control of the stimuli. These are reflexes which are automatically elicited. Therefore, it is known as respondent conditioning. However, in operant conditioning, the responses are under the control of the organism. They are voluntary responses. The organism knows he has to conduct a certain kind of a behavior. And therefore, these are known as operants. They operate in the environment and the organism is responsible for conducting them. The second difference comes from the nature of the conditioned stimulus. In classical conditioning, the conditioned stimulus and the unconditioned stimulus are clearly defined. However, in operant conditioning, the classical stimulus is not directly known. It can only be inferred by certain behavior. The third difference is from the nature of the control that is there in the experiment. In classical conditioning, the organism is passive. The experimental controls the occurrence of the entire unconditioned stimuli. However, in operant conditioning, the occurrence of reinforcement is due to learning. Here the subject is active and is instrumental or operative in getting these kind of responses or reinforcers. The difference is also in the kinds of technical terms that are used to describe these two types of conditionings. For classical conditioning, we use terms like US and CS, elicited responses or reinforcer responses. However, in operant conditioning, the terms used are reinforcers, negative reinforcers and positive reinforcers. Now students, you have gone through what is learning, what are its basic determinants, the basic types of conditioning, classical conditioning and operant conditioning. You know how they came to be established, what were the basic experiments that were done and where they are applicable in your real lives. I hope after this part, that is part 3 of your chapter 6, you would also be able to apply operant conditioning in your life to suppress certain responses or to enhance certain responses. You would also be able to understand the value of reinforcers in determining our behaviors. I wish you all the luck in your journey with psychology. Thank you.